I'm opening up with a little warning here that if you may be offended if your sense of right may be different or challenged by my own. Throughout many of my videos, I show things like the Time Magazine Waco or Xenu Loves You, L. Ron Hubbard's Dianetics, Scientology Kills, Watchtower Magazine, or even, Mary with her devastating death rays in the destruction of America and the world. Here we even see her standing there in trampling upon the serpent. Well, who's crushing the serpent's head? Who in the Bible is the Son of God? The Son of God comes to crush the serpent's head. We know that Abel was killed because the serpent didn't know what the Son of God looked like, and so the serpent is is told that he's going to be on his belly until a woman produces a seed that will come and crush his head. Well, he jumps the gun and goes after Abel because he thinks that Abel's the son that God has is rising up. He's just too excitable. He just rushes to everything to try to get things done. And then I'll show you things like the multiple the popes of the Mormon Church. They have their own structure too, and they built this whole system around a man who says he claimed he could understand hieroglyphics, reformed hieroglyphics, which, by the way, nobody's ever seen before, only they have, and takes this papyrus and writes a whole book called The Book of Abraham and comes up with the conclusion that this is what the papyrus is supposed to look like, a man standing over and is claiming that this is Abraham on the sacrificial table in Egypt, and that he writes a whole book called The Book of Abraham based on this, where we get the Council of Gods, where we get the fact that Jesus Christ and Lucifer are brothers, all these blasphemous things. And then the truth is that if anybody knows anything about any, Egyptian hieroglyphics and stuff, where you go into Egypt, you see these all over the place. This is what it normally is supposed to look like with, it's just a burial thing. Anubis's head is supposed to be on that black body. Then you got conformity, the Mormon underwear thing. And then you got this Last Days Madness book. I've read this book. This is one of the last doctrines that God had revealed to me and started showing me. And I started reading these things. But, as soon as you see the term a Roman Catholic or Catholic behind it, right away, it don't even bother. Just put it down. It's like I know that in the Quran, we know that the father-in-law of Muhammad, Muhammad had married a Catholic woman. His father-in-law was a Catholic man or a Roman Catholic, and he helped interpret some of his dreams. And so the only book I really stand behind is this book here. This is the book. This was written by Light. Light wrote this book, and darkness cannot comprehend it. Darkness cannot comprehend what's in the pages of this book until you become born again and given the Holy Spirit by which wrote this book. When you have the Holy Spirit and you're sitting down with the author of the book that wrote this, then you can begin to understand and see the truth that's going on around you, this war, this battle that's happening in the spiritual realm. The Holy Bible is necessary. In fact, if all you ever do is just read the very teachings of the Son of God, Jesus Christ, in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which is actually the heart, right? Four chambers to a heart. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. These are the four Gospels. These four Gospels reveal the teachings in the life of Jesus Christ. If you were just to follow the very teachings of Christ, then it wouldn't be hard to come along with things. So when you are offended by people at your mainline denominational churches because they cut away your ability to teach in the youth group or shut down the youth program, and you go away angry and you disobey the first teaching of Christ, which is to forgive those who do you wrong, especially if they're your brothers and sisters in Christ. If they have offended you, we are to forgive them. We are, even if they don't even ask, just forgive them and continue on, and God will reveal in time what happened, what went wrong. But if you go away angry and unforgiving, and then you pick up some doctrine written by somebody who was angry back in the Middle Ages because Luther was going around starting trouble and saying that the horror of Revelation, the Catholic Church was the horror, the harlot of Revelation, then the book that the doctrine that you're reading was written by a spirit of anger. And so now that you're angry, you're sitting there, you're reading this book, and all of a sudden it starts making sense to you. It's only because the same spirit that wrote that book. Just like if you had the Holy Spirit and you were reading the Bible, he would reveal things to you. Well, the same Spirit that writes these other books, these angry books, these unforgiving books, these books. Following Christ is a difficult thing. It's the road less traveled, and following him is hard. But if you follow me, he says, I will make you fishers of men. And I have been following Christ wherever I've gone, and he's taken me to Egypt. And as long as you believed everything in Egypt was built by man, the devil had a lie in your life. There was some darkness there. As long as you believed that everything in Egypt was built by man, because the devil had to wait for the Hebrews to come into Egypt and multiply until he could make them slaves. And why did he make them slaves? Why for 400 years? God tells Abraham for 400 years his descendants will be used as slaves. Well, God don't make slaves of anybody. He sets people free. So why is he telling Abraham before he has his first son that he's going to be a slave and know for surety they'll be taken to a foreign land? It's to hide something. And this is what he's hiding. He's hiding the two symbols of the battle of good and evil, done and built by him. See, you got a whole group out there that's saying that God has no son. Oh, yes, you've been staring at him for thousands of years. God does have a son. And this is his effigy. This is the effigy of the Son of God. This is what the devil did before the dawn of man, to build these symbols to say to God and his angels, look, if the Son of God were real, I'd take him and make him my pet. Here is this image of the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Jesus, all God had to do was name this as his symbol. And he gave it the name the Lion of the tribe of Judah that faces east in the wilderness tabernacle, faces the sun. What's he saying by facing the sun? Well, let your sun stare at your glory for a while because I'm pretty tired of it. You know, if he ever shows up, I'll make him my pet. You know, he didn't know what the Son of God looked like. And if anybody thinks that they knew what the Son of God looked like, well, they don't know the Bible. They haven't read the Bible. The Bible doesn't reveal to you that the Son of God was actually visible in presence. We know that God had the angels worship the Son. They had to, just like on earth, God is the same. He's balanced by faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. So he had the angels worship the Son. But there was they weren't convinced that the Son was real. They kept on insisting that they wanted to see the Son. But anyway, this stellar stone is kind of a real giveaway of what this thing is. And that God is revealing himself in this stellar stone. And this is before Abraham was, I am. He takes us all the way to America. And let's just build this structure. All these wars, all these battles, just to show us where the Son of God truly belongs. He doesn't belong in the dirt. He belongs high and lifted up. So America took his system, took Satan's system, the pyramid system, and turned it upside down on him. You see? Turned it upside down. And the enemy was challenged to make it his own. And so we have the Star of David, shows us the symbols of the battle of good and evil. One nation under God with liberty and justice for all. That's my God. My God has liberty and justice for all. And he's bringing justice. You see, it's once you found this out, then the rest of the Bible became very easy for you to interpret. Once you found this, because what was this? This was kind of like a game for them. The angels were waiting for someone to solve the mystery of the Sphinx and the pyramid. What did it really truly mean? It was an attack upon the character and nature of God. And he had to wait until man was in the earth to make it go away, to try and hide it. But these two symbols are the symbols of the battle of good and evil. And finding this out gave me, God blessed me, with the very lamps that Lucifer once carried. That's why in England all these crop circles that are made in a community based with my last name, because God knew one day I'd do it. See, God knew before I was even born that I was going to solve this mystery. He put me here to solve this mystery, to carry the lamps of Christ. Why me? See, Jesus was Ancient of Days. You look at Christ hanging on the cross. He was 33 years old when he died on that cross. That's when we split the perfection. The perfection of God was split. Right there, we asked God to show us the Son. We've seen the Son hanging there on the cross, the Son of God, who would die for the sins of the world. It's there at the cross that perfection is split. The Father finally leaves and turns away, never separated from his Son before. Always knew that one day the Son was necessary for creation. It's there at the cross he turns his back and leaves as the sins of the world are poured upon on his Son. Jesus is precious to God. He's worth the world to him. So this was the prize. The prize was the world. How do you get the world? Well, how do you get the world? Well, the world is falling apart. I don't know if you've noticed that there's wars and skirmishes all over the world, and everybody's looking for world peace. Well, God gave me the very lamps that Lucifer once carried, and wisdom happens to be one of them. And so God has given me his peace plan. And that peace plan is necessary in order to get the temple built in Israel. And once that temple is built, we can bring all the world's armies together under one head, so that the enemy can have his little tirade and little tantrum and take the weapons and point them at God, because that's what he was trying to get early man to do out in Egypt. Because he's not very smart. And so a lot of people are tripped up by him. A lot of people are not smart because they don't follow Christ. They don't follow Jesus. Jesus, if you do everything that Jesus says, God will reward you because you are following his son. His son is precious to him. And when you follow the teachings of Christ, and that means calling no man father, by the way. So if Jesus says to do something, you do it. You don't go and say, well, you know, everybody else does it, I'm going to do it too. Well, if everybody jumps from the bridge, are you going to jump from the bridge? If Jesus says, call no man father, guess what you do? You call no man father, because he wants to see your heart. He wants to see you set apart, that you're going to stand firm on your ground for him. He says to forgive those who do you wrong. If you don't forgive those who do you wrong, then you're not walking with Christ. You'll pick up any doctrine under any spirit, and you'll begin reading it, and you'll say, oh, I believe that, I believe that. See, most of these people who fall for these other religions and stuff like that have never got to know the gospel, have never been born again, have never been filled with the Holy Spirit, have never sat down with the very author of the book. See, there's only one book. From Genesis to Revelation, 66 books tells us how man began and how man will end. Every interpretation outside of that book, let the Holy Spirit interpret that book for you, you know. Let the Holy Spirit, let light reveal the truth to you. So the very lamps that wrote this book have come into the earth in these last days. They've preceded the return of Christ. Christ is on his way back. He says, Bobby, I want you to tell the church I'm on my way back, and tell them to begin celebrating. Well, the world needs a peace plan. The creature needs a peace plan. He doesn't have a peace plan. So where's he going to get his peace plan? Well, his peace plan is in the Bible. It's right there. It's being able to assemble the word of God in the way God intended it to be assembled. He says to rightly divide the word of truth, to rightly divide it, to see it for what it is, so that you can bring in the harvest in the last days. This whole book was written for me. I know what this book means in a much clearer sense than I've ever known before. Because of why? Because God has given me the very lamps that wrote that book for seeing the truth of his son's effigy sitting out there in Egypt. The angels needed to see a human being to show them exactly where the son belongs. And he didn't belong in the dirt. And if anybody doesn't want to lift up the Son of God, Jesus says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. If nobody wants to lift this truth up and draw the world to Christ, then if you're going to leave the son in the dirt, think about what you're saying to God about staying in the dirt. Resurrection's coming, brothers and sisters, and I don't care what the latter-day madness nutcases say. Resurrection, my last name, means beautiful place where most of these crop circles are made, right? 007's car, the number five thing, and the number five has followed me all throughout my life. You know, my initials are B-A-B-E-L. You drop the first B. God is giving you clues. We left clues all throughout Scripture to what is going on here, what is happening here. What is happening here is God is trying to teach his creation that rebellion leads to where we are today. And if you want it to stop, you need to give your life to Jesus Christ. Through Christ, Christ living in you will bring peace. That's the only way you will get peace. And God will not allow any other peace plan to unfold. Only through the foot of the cross, only through Christ, will you find peace and joy and happiness. Does God have a son? Been staring at them out there in Egypt for over 6,000 years. People have been looking at it and scratching their heads. How did they build it? How did they do that? Well, you have to consider how big they were when they were here before man. And you have to consider at the same time that they were here, so was the dinosaur. I think the angels were kind of giving us some clues in some of the cartoons that we watched as a kid, even in Toy Story, which is one I'm going to do very shortly, and show you the plan of God right out there. The angels influence us in our videos, in our movies, and in our television, trying to get us to come to know the truth. This concludes part one of the offense.